Hello friends, welcome to our channel about notes. It is the second part of our chapter New Kings and Kingdoms. In the first part, we have studied the emerging new dynasties. In 7th to 12th centuries, Dante Durga's Hiranyagarbha Puja, administration in the kingdom, the types of taxes and their recruitment policies. If you miss the first part, please go through it for the better understanding. The link of the first part is given in the description below. In the second part of a chapter, we are going to study prashastis of kings. Prashastis is also called as a stuti in Hindi and prashansa in Marathi. Also, we will study the different war fought by different dynasties. The collection of wealth, we will talk about the temples, the agriculture and administration of an empire. So let's start the first topic. So the topic is prashastis and land grants. As I already explained what prashastis means. Prashasti means stuti in Hindi. It is a written document to praise the kings. It is generally written by the Brahmins. Those Brahmins sometimes helped in the administration. These prashastis are always used to show how valiant the king was. Valiant means the person full of courage and the person does not fear from anything. Those prashastis may not be always true. Now look at the image of prashasti. This prashasti was written for the achievements of King Nagavatta. This is found at the Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh. The language used here is Sanskrit. In this prashasti, the victory over different lands is praised. And similarly, you can find the same type of claims in the other kings' prashastis. So here's the question for you. Why do they make these claims? Please write down your answer in the comment box. You can pause the video to read this prashasti. Let's move forward. As the king gets their work done by the Brahmins, so in the reward to that work, kings often donate or grants some land to them. As we see, any administration records the data for their work. Similarly, recording of data was happening in that period also. The records were recorded on a copper plates. The image shown here is one of such records made during the 9th century. On these records, it is written partly in Tamil and partly in Sanskrit. Can you see the ring holding the plates together? That ring is secured with a royal seal. That seal is to indicate that this is an authentic document. Now you can see the another picture. What is written in the land record? It is written here. This is the one of the land record of the Cholas, also called as a land grant. Pause the video and read the record. After reading, you will get to know that all the entities, water bodies, their borders and authorities to do with the lands are recorded here. We have seen what is prashasti. Now let's see. An author named Kalana made a long poem containing the history of kings ruled over Kashmir. In this poem, instead of writing prashasti, he was criticized the rulers and their policies. This author went against the kings. The sources he used to consider while writing were documents, eyewitness people, previous histories and inscription, etc. Moving to the next topic, warfare for wealth. Warfare means engagement into the fight. Here we will see what the kings did for the sake of wealth. All those kings were ruling over a specific region. But as we can say, with their increased needs, those kings wanted to rule over other areas too. One such region is known as Kanauj in Ganga Valley. it was a flourished region, and the kingdom of Gurjara, Pratihara, Rashtrakuta and Pala fought over this same Kanauj region, and they fought for centuries over this same region. Because of that, three kingdoms fought over one region. Some historians described it as a tripartite struggle. Tripartite means having three parts or involving three people into a thing. As we have seen, the kings used to show their power by building big temples and buildings, and showcasing their wealth by putting golds and jewels in the temples. So, in this warfare of wealth, the attackers often choose the big temples to steal their rich wealth. You will get to know that in the chapter 5. So, for now, we will see that one of the best known ruler was Sultan Muhammad of Ghazni from Afghanistan. He came from Afghanistan and ruled over a period of 1997 to 1030. He invaded the part of Central Asia, Iran and northwest part of our subcontinent India. He came and stole India almost every year, and he mostly targeted wealthy temples. One such example is he did with the extremely rich temple of Somnath, which is in Gujarat. Somnath is one of the Jyotirling among 12. Sultan Muhammad Ghazni raided, destroyed the Somnath temple and took all the wealth to its country Afghanistan to develop his city Ghazni. Okay, look how he used our wealth to develop their city and destroyed ours. Sultan Muhammad was also interested in finding out more about the kings he conquered. For that, he appointed a scholar named Al-Biruni to write an account of the subcontinent. This Arabic work known as Kitab-ul-Hind. This Kitab-ul-Hind remains an important source for the historians. Also, he consulted Sanskrit scholars to prepare this Kitab-ul-Hind. Talking about other kings, the Chahamanas, known as the Chauhans, ruled over a region around Delhi and Ajmer. They tried to expand their region to west and east, but they were opposed by the Chalukyas of Gujarat and Gadavas of western Uttar Pradesh. The great king of Chahamanas was Prithviraj III, also known as Prithviraj Chauhan. He fought with Afghan ruler Sultan Muhammad Ghori in 1191. But again, in the second battle with the Muhammad Ghori in 1192, Prithviraj Chauhan lost his life and lost that battle too. Now, look at the map and observe how Cholas expanded their region over the subcontinent. Here you can pause the video for a better look. In this map, you can see the Chalukyas, Kalingas beside the region of the Cholas. Now, the next topic is from Urayur to Tanjavur, in which we will see how Cholas rise to power. A small chiefly family known as a Muthurayur, having their power at the Kaveri Delta. You can see the Kaveri Delta here in the map. Okay. So, this Muthurayur were from the Pallavas king. What happened is, the Vijayalaya belongs to the Cholas from Urayur, captured the delta of Kaveri from the Muthurayur in 9th century. And then, they built the famous town of Tanjavur and temple of goddess Nishumbha Shudini. The successors. What successor means? Successor means the later generation of the king. So the Vijayalaya successor conquered the neighboring region and grew in a size and power. The Rajarajavan was the most powerful Chola ruler, became king in 985 and expanded control over the most of these areas. He also recognized an administration of the empire. Rajaraja's son Rajendra I continued his policies and even raided the Ganga Valley. He also raided the Sri Lanka and the countries of Southeast Asia, and he also developed a navy for these expeditions. Now, moving to the next topic, splendid temples and bronze sculpture. You know, the big temples of Tanjavur and Gangaikonda Cholapuram, built by Rajaraja and Rajendra, are the architectural and sculptural marvels. The Chola temples became the center of settlements, which grew around them particularly for the craft production. Rulers and people endowed the temples, means giving some money and property or land to this temple. This temple land were used to maintain the expenses of the people who worked at the temple. Those people are priest, garland maker, means pushpamala makers, the cooks, the sweepers, musicians, dancers, etc. In such way, temples became the hub of economic, social and cultural life. As the everything of the living world was happening there, it is obvious to become a cultural hub. Amongst the craft associated with the temples, the making of bronze image was the most distinctive. Chola's bronze image are considered among the finest in the world. While most images were of the deities, sometimes images were made of the devotees as well. Here you can see one of the bronze sculpture in the Chola's period made during their region. In the figure it is written that a Chola bronze sculpture, and see how detailed the sculpture is. Now see agriculture and irrigation in Chola's period. Agriculture was responsible for the Chola's new development. Look at the map where you can see the river Kaveri. Okay, here you can see the river Kaveri on the lower level, on the lower side of this map. Okay, Kaveri's branches near the sea to the Bay of Bengal. Those branch channels of rivers Kaveri overflow frequently, so that the deposits of fertile soil at their bank. You might have learned about this in geography, that fertile soil is very useful to grow good agriculture. And that time, the ample amount of river water used for the high cultivation of rice. Although agriculture had developed earlier in other parts of Tamil Nadu, it was only from the 5th or 6th century that this area was opened up for a large scale cultivation. Forest had to be cleared in some regions. Land had to be leveled in some areas. In the delta region, embankments had to be built to prevent floodings, and canals had to be constructed to carry water to the fields. In many areas, two crops were grown in a year. Now see, in many cases, it was necessary to water crops artificially, like in summer. So the people of that time used variety of methods for the irrigation. In some areas, they were dug the wells. In other places, huge tanks were constructed to collect rainwater. Those irrigation works required planning, organizing, labor and resources, and maintaining these works and to decide how the water is to be shared among many people, they do a thing. And what they did for that, most of the new rulers as well as a people living in a village took an active interest in this. Let's see the administration of the empire. First, understood some of the terms. The group or settlements of peasants are known as Ur. The spelling for the Ur is U-R. And the group of village are called as a Nadu. How do we spell it? N-A-D-U. It is the group of a village, Nadu, and the settlement of a peasants are known as Ur. Due to the agriculture, peasants, that is Ur, became rich, and to do justice and collecting taxes from them, the Nadu and the village council at the king's court provide administrative function to do this. Rich peasants of the Velala caste used considerable control over the affairs of the Nadu under the supervision of the central Chola government. The Chola kings have some rich landowners, titles like Muvvendavelam, which means a velan or a peasant serving three kings, Ariyar, which means a chief, etc. As the markers of respect and entrusted them with the important office of the state at the center. Look at the box written here for the types of land. The Chola inscription mentions several categories of lands, such as Vellana Vagai. Vellana Vagai is a land of non-Brahmana peasants proprietors. Second one is the Brahmadeya. Brahmadeya means a land gifted to the Brahmins. The third one is Shalabhoga. Shalabhoga is a land for the maintenance of a school. Then the next to it is the Devadana or Tiru Namakuttakanni. It is the land gifted to the temples. And the last one is the Palli Chandanam, which is the land donated to the Jain institutions. We have seen that Brahmins often received lands, grants or Brahmadeya. As a result, a large number of Brahmana settlements emerged in the Kaveri Valley as in the other parts of South India. Each Brahmadeya was looked after by an assembly or sabha of prominent Brahmana landholders. These assemblies worked very efficiently. Their decisions were recorded in detail in inscriptions. Often, their decisions carved on stones or on the walls of a temple. Association of traders known as the Nagarams also occasionally performed administrative functions in the town. The inscription from Uttaramerur in Chingaleput district, Tamil Nadu, provide details of the way in which the Sabha was organized. The Sabha had a separate committees to look after irrigation works, gardens, temples, etc. So, now we will see how do they choose the members for their committee. To select the members, they call all the eligible members and write their name on the tickets of a palm leaf. Then they put those tickets into an earthen pot. After putting those tickets into an earthen pot, a young boy was asked to take out the tickets one by one from the pot, and in this way the committee is getting selected. Moving to the next picture, inscription and text. In this text you will see the eligibility of a person to be a member of a committee sabha, and in the second paragraph, which is taken from the inscription, talks about the lives of a ordinary men and women, unlike the kings and the big landlord. You can pause the video to read this text. Okay, here at the end of the chapter, one interesting information is given about the China under the Tang Dynasty. This incident is happened in the same time period which we are studying. So I will read this for you. The China under the Tang Dynasty. In China, an empire was established under the Tang Dynasty, which remained in power for about 300 years, from the 7th century to the 10th centuries. Its capital is Xi'an, was one of the largest city in the world, visited by the Turks, Iranians, Indians, Japanese and Koreans. The Tang Empire was administrated by a bureaucracy recruited through an examination, which was open to all who wished to appear for it. This system of selecting officials remained in place with some changes till 1911. So here's the question for you. In what ways was this system different from those prevalent in the Indian subcontinent? So guys, here is the end of this chapter. I hope you understood and enjoyed the video. Post your queries and answers to the question asked in this chapter in the comment box, and soon I will post the worksheets on this channel about this chapter. Here I have one good news for you. We have started a geography subject lectures on our channel. So find out the lecture by clicking in the links in the video description. Please like, share, comment and subscribe to our channel. Best of luck.